One of the most satisfying things any sports fan can experience is watching their team completely demolish a bitter rival. Sure, for the rest of us in the sports-loving world, it's a pretty dull affair, but damn if a well-earned, well-executed ass-stomping don't feel good if it's going your way. Domination will occasionally pop up in every sport, it's just a fundamental part of competition. And when it does happen, it's usually pretty easy to quantify. Hell, in most sports, there's a built-in point system specifically for this purpose. The biggest margin of victory ever racked up in an NFL game was at the 1940 NFL Championship game, in which the Chicago Bears absolutely thrashed the Washington Redskins 73-0. The biggest margin of victory in the NHL was in 1944, where the Detroit Red Wings shut out the New York Rangers 15-0. Most of these records were set decades ago in a sport's infancy, and even the more quote-unquote recent records happened when I was barely old enough to talk. In 1991, the Cleveland Cavaliers whooped the Miami Heat 148-80 for the biggest margin of victory ever in the NBA. And in college basketball, Troy State beat DeVry 258-141, or 253-141. Whichever score is accurate, it's still an ungodly amount of points, the likes of which are comically out of proportion. NASCAR is a somewhat similar case, and many of the all-time records have remained etched in stone for most of our lifetimes. Rule changes and schedule shakeups have kept the most impressive feats and dominant performances of all time completely unreachable. But how do you even quantify dominating a NASCAR race? Maybe you'd use margin of victory again. In 1965, Ned Jarrett won the Southern 500 by a staggering 14 full laps. He'd won some races at short tracks by more than 20, but that Southern 500 win was special, as it was held at the Darlington Raceway, a mile and a third super speedway. Going by number of laps times the track length, he won by a ridiculous 19 miles. However, it's worth noting that he was not the favorite to win that day. Darrell Derringer had led 199 of 364 laps, and Ned had only 62 laps led to his credit. Gentleman Jarrett had only taken the top spot due to a mechanical failure on Derringer's car. So you could make the argument that Jarrett didn't actually dominate the race. So margin of victory doesn't really work in quantifying domination here in NASCAR. So let's go with the old standby, number of laps led. Who led the most miles ever in a NASCAR Top Tier Series race? You may think this had to have happened before the birth of your parents, out on some far-flung dusty dirt track in the middle of nowhere that has since been lost to time. But no, this race was televised. Millions of people saw this happen in real time. The winner is still racing today, and it happened just 5 years ago. At the Coca-Cola 600 on May 29th, 2016, Martin Truex Jr. put together the most perfect race anybody has ever run. 392 of 400 laps led for a total of 588 miles spent at the top spot out of a total of 600. It was just flawless. Sure, other drivers have led all the laps of a given race. The most recent driver to do so was Jeff Burton at New Hampshire in 2000, although new restrictor plates put in place over safety concerns probably had a lot to do with it. Passing was difficult all day, and the cautions felt just perfect, so Jeff could pit and still maintain the lead. Martin Truex had no such luck. There were only four cautions on the day for the longest race of the year, and green flag pit stops meant that Truex had to give up the lead at some point. Jimmy Johnson led 5 laps and Paul Menard led 2. Those were the only two drivers to lead multiple laps that day besides Truex. With just 4 yellows, this also became the fastest 600 ever at 3 hours, 44 minutes, and 5 seconds long from flag to flag. Had a few more yellows been thrown at the right times, I have no doubt that Truex would have led all 600 miles. But winner of the fastest ever longest race of the year is a pretty good consolation prize. To say this win came out of left field is an understatement. NASCAR since the turn of the millennium has experienced an era of considerable parity. We routinely get more than a dozen winners per year, and it was largely considered that no one driver could ever get away from the pack like this anymore. But that day, Truex showed up and curb-stomped the entire field. And to think this was just the fourth win of his entire career. Martin Truex Jr. of Mayetta, New Jersey, had spent years languishing with dying or underperforming teams. And when he moved over to Furniture Row Racing, everyone thought it would be the end of his career. In 2014, he was abysmal, but in 2015, he got win number 3, and 2016 would see him nab 4 more W's in total. Wait, Furniture Row Racing? That's a bit of an odd name for a motorsports team, wouldn't you think? Yeah, the team was started by Barney Visser in 2005, who owned a chain of furniture stores out in Denver, Colorado, far away from the NASCAR heartland of the Southeast. One day, he just decided to go NASCAR racing and the rest was history. This win was just the third victory for the entire organization. The man who orchestrated this masterpiece of a race was crew chief for the number 78 car, Cole Pearn. a Canadian who just the year prior became the first Canadian crew chief to ever win a NASCAR Cup Series race. So just to recap, a Yankee driver, a Canadian crew chief, and a team based out of Denver with their financial backing mostly coming from furniture sales are the people responsible for the most perfect run in NASCAR history. You just cannot make this stuff up. Oh, and just to add to that insanity, they'd win the championship 1 year later in 2017. Prior to this race, you would have thought that Jim Pascal's 1967 feat at the 600 would go untouched forever. That day, he spent 335 of 400 laps in P1 for a total of 502 miles led. Far and away the most dominant run of any driver up to that point in many decades after. But Martin Truex shattered that record with prejudice. I'm tempted to say this record will never be topped, but the fact that it happened just 5 years ago makes me stop to reconsider. So many of NASCAR's records have been claimed long ago and have stood untouched for the majority of the sport's history. For something like this to happen so recently is just mind-boggling. And it's really only possible at this one race. The Coca-Cola 600, formerly known as the World 600, has been held on Memorial Day weekend for most of its history. Its first running in 1960 was in response to the Indy 500. NASCAR wanted a marquee event to compete with it, so they bumped the distance an extra 100 miles just for good measure. Other than a one-off race at Michigan, this is the only event of this distance in all of NASCAR. If you're going to beat this mark set by Truex, you only have one shot at it per year. And the 600 is arguably the toughest race in NASCAR to win. Not only is it absurdly long, but it starts in the late afternoon in 90 degree heat and ends at night, causing track conditions to change drastically. It's extremely rare to see somebody who led the first 100 miles be just as good for the next 500. Despite Truex's flawless performance, Kevin Harvick finished in second, just 2.5 seconds back after a 55 lap green flag run to wrap things up. Although Kevin Harvick admitted he thought Truex was just coasting around at that point. That being said, this race probably caused many of you at the time to doze off or change the channel. That is, unless you were a Martin Truex fan. If I were on Twitter back then, I probably would have seen a flood of tweets deriding the race and calling for an immediate change to the aero package. Even today, not a whole lot of people look back at this race fondly, despite how monumental and historic it still is. But every one of us NASCAR fans needs to appreciate this for what it is, a flawless work of art. Would I want to see a race like this every week? No, of course not. But these little moments in history are what make sports feel like the most important thing in the world. It's what makes every race and every game fun to watch. You never know when history will be made, and certainly the tens of thousands of people in attendance that night had no idea what they were about to witness. We got close to another monumental performance back in 2020. At the first Martinsville race, Joey Logano had put on a clinic in the opening laps of the race, and by lap 60, only 18 cars were left on the lead lap. I am by no means a Joey Logano fan, trust me, I don't like the guy. But some part of me did hope that he'd do something that hadn't been done since 1994, lap the field. The last guy to do that was Jeff Bodine at North Wilkesboro, another short track. And it's my humble opinion that watching something like that happen today would be pretty damn cool no matter who it was. This is where I get to my larger point about appreciating every sporting event for what it is. It may not be the most riveting thing to watch, but there's always some little bit of history being made, whether you realize it or not, or whether you like it or not. For example, in November of 2011, number 1 and number 2 in college football, LSU and Alabama, met in the regular season. Both were undefeated and eyeing a championship. They called the matchup Armageddon, the game of the century, and it ended with a score of 9-6 for LSU in overtime. Most complained the game was boring and a snooze fest, but for me, I loved it. It was oddly mesmerizing to watch two teams play completely lights-out defense. Neither team ever even got close to the red zone. It was a defensive clinic. Again, I wouldn't want every game to be like this, but it was truly fascinating in a way I haven't seen since. And that, in a nutshell, is the 2016 Coca-Cola 600. A complete masterclass in nailing the setup and racing flawlessly. We may never see its like ever again, but with a new car on the way and lots of new tracks coming down the pipe, who knows? Anyway, I'm Slapshoes, thanks for watching. And until next time, y'all take it easy.